Starting off week 10 of the Bobcast here with head softball coach Bill Vasco. Coach, we're finally getting you on the Bobcast this season. You had an early season tournament down in Chawan and swept that weekend, three losses. But was it helpful to you to have your kind of 2 week break there between that opening weekend and then this past weekend?
Yeah, absolutely. Considering that, we hadn't been outside on the field before we went down to Chawan, and actually, with the way things are set up with COVID protocols for practices inside, we hadn't had a single team practice where everybody was together prior to going down to play. So it was beneficial just to get out and have the opportunity to play some games. It was disappointing to lose three games, but we were really competitive considering the circumstances, and then being able to come back and have 2 weeks off to work on the things that we saw in those three games against Chawan was really helpful. So, we made a lot of improvements from that first weekend to the second weekend, and hopefully we'll continue to get even better from here on out.
It certainly was a big improvement. You defeated Salem in a doubleheader 10-1 in five innings and then 7-0 in a shutout. We'll talk about the first game first. And Sydney Theobald, who's a first-year pitcher for you guys, just one run allowed, and that one was on a wild pitch on just two hits in that game. How impressed were you with her in her first game pitching that wasn't at Chawan?
I thought she did really well keeping Salem at bay. Like you said, two hits, and her only mistake was having a leadoff walk in one inning, and eventually that run scored on a wild pitch. But otherwise, she was really composed. Did a great job of working ahead on batters and keeping runners off base, and the defense backed her up, and obviously we scored some runs. So very happy with her to get her first collegiate win in that game, and to start us off on a good tone for the doubleheader on Saturday.
And now that game really was blown open in that third inning where you scored 9 runs, and 6 of those were scored with 2 outs. You were helped out by an error on the defense, but what was it in that inning, especially with 2 outs, that your hitters were just able to keep going and going and going and not get that third out to end that inning?
Well, we struggled hitting at Chawan, and that was the big emphasis in our practices over the last 2 weeks, was to continue to improve the hitting aspect, especially with runners in scoring position. At Chawan, we left a lot of runners on base, especially in scoring position. And, I still felt like we left too many runners on this past Saturday, but starting off on Saturday, the first couple of innings, I felt everybody was still a little bit tight and just waiting for, somebody to make something happen before they all kind of relaxed and took a deep breath. And that inning, you could just see it. There was a total transformation in the way we were swinging the bats that carried on throughout the rest of the day. So it was nice to finally, get a big hit, score a couple of runs, and then everybody kind of just said, hey, I'm going to be the next person up and continue that. So I just think being able to relax a little bit and get back into the groove, after so much turmoil over the last year with everything that's happened, it was kind of like, we looked like a totally different team once we kind of settled in. So,
and so after that first pitching performance from Sydney, I mean, you can't ask much more of a coach with just two hits and one run. But then Shauna Lehrin comes in the second game. She throws a complete game shutout with just three hits and five strikeouts herself. And she also pitched pretty well, considering it was her first game down at Chawan as well. But what has Shauna shown you from this early season, especially with throwing a shutout and basically her second or third start?
Yeah, she picked up, right where Sid left off, and again, worked ahead on batters. Actually had a perfect game going through, I think, into the sixth inning. So did a really good job of, just attacking the batters and keeping them off base. And, she's thrown really well. Looks like her ERA is below a 2.0 so far this year. So doing a good job of just limiting the batters. And, I think our entire pitching staff has done a good job in limiting walks. And then our defense has really helped out. It's played really well and limited free bases as well. So, she did a great job just shutting them down, and being able to get the shutout to complete the doubleheader sweep was really nice. And proud of her and all of our pitchers.
Now, on the offensive side, it's been very balanced this year, but one hitter certainly that stood out over the weekend was Katie Ernst, who went 4-for-6 with 4 RBI and has now jumped into the lead for RBI on the season. But what have you seen from her in the box that's made her so successful?
The one thing that we noticed as coaches throughout practices is that Katie swings at a lot of pitches, some that aren't really in the zone either, but she does a really great job of putting those balls into play. So she's really tough to get out or have her swing and miss. So she makes really great contact on a lot of pitches. Going up and just swinging and being aggressive, which is kind of the mindset we've been working with on all of our hitters. She's kind of really followed through on that. And, I think we really saw that on Saturday that she put the ball in play a lot and hit it hard and it fell in a lot of great spots. And she came up in opportunities to be able to drive in some runs and did what, we ask our hitters to do to when we have people on base and people in scoring position, we need to pick them up and score them. So really happy to see her have a great day on Saturday and be successful like that.
And I just talked a little bit about the balance. I looked up and you have 9 players with at least 10 at bats on the season, and 8 of those players at least have one RBI. Shauna Leonard, who's the pitcher, is the only one that doesn't have that RBI in 10 at bats. But how important is it to you that your entire offense has been able to generate some runs when, some teams it's just the top of the lineup or that middle hitters that they're the only ones that are going to produce? But for you guys, it's been every up and down the lineup.
I think, like you said, balance is a key word. We have a lot of people who can come up and put the ball in play and take advantage of their opportunity. So I think it's still early in the season, and it's nice that we've had some chances to see different people at the plate. And we're heading into conference play now, but I still feel like we're going to be shuffling some people in and out to give people opportunities to see what people can do. But, having that balance makes you feel like you don't have to worry about, if someone's struggling on a particular day, that you have several other people that are going to be able to pick things up and take advantage of those opportunities. So, I think, we made great strides in what we did hitting on Saturday, and I don't think we're even close to what our potential is as a team to be able to do some things on offense. So I'm really looking forward to our continued improvement and everybody to keep competing and battling with each other on the team to make each other better, to give us the best opportunity to win some games.
Now, one final stat that really kind of jumped out at me for you guys in the early season was the stolen base count, where you guys are 24 for 25 on the season. Breonna Powell herself is 7 for 7. Is that something that you really see this team as kind of being their identity on offense and on the base passes, being able to generate extra bases off of stealing and having a really high success rate so far?
Yeah, that's definitely something we've emphasized the last couple of years, and kudos to everyone on the team that they've really bought in what we've worked on in terms of technique. That if we can get on base, we're going to try to turn whatever it is into another extra base or two extra bases by stealing every opportunity that we have, and we have some really fast people on the team who do a great job, but regardless of individual speed, we have a lot of people who their technique is really good, and they understand that when they get on base and we have an opportunity, we're going to try to get an extra base. And Saturday we had our first runner thrown out, so that's a pretty good percentage to go 20 and something before getting somebody thrown out. So we're going to continue to do that. I anticipate as we head into conference play, people are going to start to see video and the stats and understand what we're trying to do. It's going to make it a little bit tougher. So I'm hoping our players can rise to that challenge and keep working on getting even better on that. But, we're going to keep being aggressive and try to get as many extra bases as we can by stealing. So we'll keep the gas pedal down and keep working on that.
Now, you just talked about conference play, and this upcoming weekend, you're finally going to get to play in the MEC for the
Yes.
first time after last season, having, right before you're about to start conference play, the season's cut short. You got Saturday against DNE and Sunday against West Virginia Wesleyan, both of them double headers. So it's going to be a pretty loaded weekend for you guys, but, certainly excited to see you guys in conference play for the first time.
I know that the entire team is excited to be able to not only open conference play, but to do it at home and have some home games, because we didn't get to have any home games last year either. So that's exciting. It's also at the same time, a little bit of uncertainty because we still don't know what the Mountain East is all about, and it's our first opportunity to go against these opponents. And you know, going into this weekend, I don't believe D&E has played yet. I think that we're their opening games this Saturday, so you know, we don't really know much about them as a team since we haven't played them before and they haven't played yet. And I think Wesleyan, I'm not sure if they played this past week and didn't have a chance to look yet or not, but I know they were supposed to play Fairmont earlier last week and it got rained out. So, you know, both teams that we're facing are coming in on limited playing experience. So it's a little bit of an unknown, but, you know, it's really exciting to kind of jump into conference and get things going. And it's, you know, with 32 conference games, that's a long conference season. So a lot of opportunities, but it'll be really fun just to get things started and see where we're at.
Well, it's certainly exciting to see you guys back here at Bobcat Field, where you guys are finally able to play at home in the MEC. So thank you for taking the time out of your morning to come and talk to us on the Bobcast. And we certainly wish you the best of luck this weekend.
All right. Thank you. My pleasure.
Back here on the Bobcast, and for the first time this season, we welcome in women's lacrosse with head coach Taylor Sindahl. Coach, first year that you get to be a head coach of a collegiate program, what's it been like to start out your head coaching career here at Frostburg State so far?
Honestly, it's been great. I think the staff here has been super supportive, and the girls have really bought in from the beginning. I think they see the potential of this team and, you know, what future success we can have. So I'm just excited to get through year one and continue our progress forward.
Now, for this team, it was their first time playing in 368 days. But for you yourself, compared to a lot of coaches here, you're actually inheriting a pretty experienced roster compared with, you know, I know field hockey has a ton of first-year players, and Kerry Saunders with women's basketball has a lot of first-year and sophomore players. But you have a good amount of sophomores, juniors, and seniors with which previous coaches have built that you get to inherit. So what's it been like to be able to come in and have some, you know, some leadership compared to, you know, a lot of teams where they have a lot of first-year players?
Honestly, I think it's been great. The upperclassmen, while, you know, they weren't used to our coaching style yet, like I said, they really bought in and they've been able to kind of bring the freshmen along. But we also have a lot of really talented first years that are seeing a lot of playing time. So I think they're also pushing those upperclassmen to continue to push themselves and get better and not stay complacent. So it's been a great, you know, mix to work with.
And so you begin this year, it was a 20-4 loss to the number 10 team in the country, East Stroudsburg, where they've built pretty much a powerhouse there up in Pennsylvania for the past few years. What was it like? You know, that was kind of a late add for them, for you guys to play against them. But, you know, what was it like to play against such a talented team and kind of show your players like, hey, this is the top of Division II. This is where we want to get to.
So I think, you know, we knew that they were going to be talented and that they, you know, have a storied history of being, you know, one of the top teams in Division II. But we came out and those first 10 minutes, I was like, this is going to be a game. We, you know, we're going to give them a run for their money. And I think, you know, mixed with first game jitters for the freshmen, for, you know, the returners haven't played in, like we said, 368 days, new coaching staff, I think a lot of things mixed together where we were just nervous. So I don't think by any means we had our best showing against them. I think if we played them later in the season, it definitely would be a closer game. We're also dealing with a lot of injuries right now. So again, like, I think if we were to play them later, it would be different, but I'm glad we got it out of the way now against the number 10 team in the country, get out all the bad. And the good news is no one can scout us really because we didn't really show what we were capable of. So, you know, I think the girls took that loss to heart, but they've come back ready to work and they never want to feel that way again.
And so you talked about that opening 10 minutes, and I think it was, you know, you held them scoreless for the first 9 minutes and then they scored those three goals and within 3 minutes and kind of shell-shocked you guys. But what was it from your team that allowed you to be so successful to start that game from a team that certainly is going to be in contention for the national championship later this year?
So I think we came out, you know, really hard and really excited. Like, the energy was great. And our goalie, she's a freshman, Whitney Crosby, she played lights out the entire game, but especially in those first 10 minutes. I think at one point she had three or four saves, like, back to back to back. So she really gave us that spark that we needed. And then unfortunately, once they did score a goal, I think we again got a little scared and we were like, oh yeah, they are good. But no, I really want to give credit to Whitney. She did a phenomenal job, especially in those first 10 minutes, but throughout the entire game when she was in.
And so I also want to bring, you just brought up Whitney Crosby, who certainly as a first-year goalkeeper, you kind of trial by fire, we'll call it, coming in against that offense. And also McKenna Shea, who you have two first-year goalkeepers, who McKenna was able to come in later in the game. Is it something that you see as, you know, kind of competition for each other of, you know, you're both first-year players, we don't have an experienced goalkeeper, so you guys are going to have to both fight it out for the starting position this year?
Yeah, I think it's been awesome to see those two, you know, cheer each other on and work together, but they're constantly pushing each other every single day. And I also think it's been great for our defense to have someone who's played goalie before in the goal. I know last year, you know, they had a field player in the goal. So I think that has really given our defense like a renewed sense of hope and energy that, you know, we have someone as that last line of defense who we can trust, where if we make a mistake, you know, they're going to back us up. But I really think, you know, the competition between those two is super healthy, but it's really elevating both of their games to the next level. So really excited for those two.
So one player that I wanted to bring up that kind of stood out all around was Summer Cavey, who chipped in with a goal and assist and also had a cause turnover on her day. And certainly a senior on this team that is very experienced. Her sister also playing here, kind of a storied career in her own right, but Summer certainly, you know, from the midfield position, where it's arguably the most important position in lacrosse, certainly from a field perspective. But what did you see from her on that day that, you know, she was able to kind of fill up the stat sheet?
Summer is just one of those players that comes like once every few years. She is just the heart and soul of this team as far as never giving up. She's, we like to say, all gas, no brakes. She literally never stops. At one point in the preseason, she actually broke one of our defender's sticks because she was just going so hard to the goal. She's one of those kids where you say, hey, I need a goal, I need a draw control, I need this or that. She goes out there and does it. She's super competitive. She holds herself to a really high standard. And, you know, again, she's just one of those kids that you love to coach because you know she's going to do whatever it takes to get you what you need. So we're really excited to have her this year and are trying to convince her to come back for a fifth year. So I'll keep you posted on that.
Certainly that waiver helps out every team. Absolutely. And certainly with a player as talented as she is, you know, it can only be for a positive to bring her on for another year. So I want to, you know, in a more general sense of you, we just kind of talked before this of, you know, what you take away from a 20-4 loss. Obviously there's not a lot of game field that you're going to go back on, but you know, what do you say to your team after a game like that, where, you know, a lot of these players, they played in the CAC, which is arguably the top conference for women's lacrosse in Division III. You know, you have York, Mary Washington, and Salisbury, all top 10 teams in the country, where, you know, they would, you know, kind of have these blowout losses. But moving up to Division II, they might, you know, expect a different level of competition. What do you say to your team, you know, following something like this, where, you know, some of them are kind of used to it, but they might have to learn these lessons later on?
So I basically said, you know, at least we got it out of the way now. And on paper, you know, that score makes sense. East Stroudsburg is the number 10 team in the country. People see that score and they don't think, wow, Frostburg is bad. They think, wow, East Stroudsburg is as good as, you know, everyone makes them out to be. But to us, we know that we didn't play to our full potential. And, you know, I think the first 10 minutes shows that we could have hung in with them. And then, you know, we kind of let off a little bit, but I just keep telling them, you know, we have to be better than this. And we know that we didn't play what we're capable of. We didn't play Frostburg lacrosse. And so that's the positive, is that the next time we step on the field, hopefully we play our game of lacrosse and it's a better outcome. So we know what we need to work on. But for the most part, it's just a lot of little things that unfortunately added up to a big loss. But you know, the girls have really come ready to work this last week, and we've been pushing them really hard. We've been conditioning more. We've been focusing on those things like ground balls and stick work that we need to do to fix, you know, what happened in the East Stroudsburg game. But they said, we never want to feel this way again. And, you know, fingers crossed, that's our only loss this season.
And so you have the chance to rectify this. You get of basically a full week and a couple days to prepare from last Tuesday coming up for this Thursday, where you have four straight home games, which for any team, especially in this pandemic, they're not going to have that opportunity. But you guys have Walsh coming up on Thursday. What are you expecting for this kind of home stretch where you don't have to travel on the road for a month, basically?
We're excited about it. I think it's great for our girls to, you know, really settle in, but also hopefully we get a lot of fans coming out. We have a great support system, so hopefully we can have that home field advantage. But I think Walsh is going to be a tough one. I mean, they just played Mercyhurst yesterday, and they lost 17-10, but they never gave up. And so that's something we need to be prepared for. We can't get complacent or think that wins are just going to be handed to us because we're at home or because we were picked to win our conference. So I'm hoping that we can come out ready to play on Thursday, and that can just start the momentum, and then we can just keep the train rolling through not only these home games, but the rest of the season.
Well, we certainly wish you the best of luck starting on Thursday and then continuing throughout the rest of the season. Thank you for taking the time out of your morning to come and talk to us.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Back on the Bobcast this week, and we're bringing in Shane Brookshire for the second time, but it's the first time that you get to talk about your track and field team, obviously having your cross-country team on last week. But your first meet of the season down at Glenville State, a two-day meet on Saturday and Sunday. Your men were able to finish second, just finishing behind Charleston over the weekend, and the women finishing in sixth place. What did you make overall of both of your team's performances over the weekend?
For it being the first outdoor meet for everybody in 2 years, pretty much, I think it was a great start for us. We did see a lot of rust on some of the performances, like athletes making their collegiate debuts and longer events. But for the most part, we did have an extremely successful weekend. And I mean, I obviously had some great performances, like several PRs. I think we had roughly around 12 or 13 PRs across the board. And a lot of the newcomers stepping up throughout the day, and a lot of the returners just picking up right from where we left off at last year. So all in all, it was a good weekend.
So one of the newcomers that I want to start out with is Alyssa Mullery, who won the 100-meter hurdles and also was fourth in the high jump, which, you know, certainly from my days in running track in high school, didn't really see a ton of you go from hurdles to high jump in terms of what you could do as an athlete. But very impressive from her over the weekend to pick up the first victory for the women. What have you seen from the first year in these couple of weeks where you've been practicing and then in the meet?
Well, with Alyssa, she was great for us last year in the indoor championship. So this is her first year running college outdoor. And this is one of her best times in the 100 hurdles, the 15.69. She didn't really have much competition. I think she won by about 0.3 seconds, which is actually a pretty good distance in a sprint race. And she does run better when she's got faster people that are with her. And so I believe this is one of the fastest times that she's ever opened up with, even throughout high school. So I think she's going to have a great season. I said, a lot of these athletes, they've had to go through so much changes this year and have adjusted really well, especially a lot of our first years, not only the changes with the COVID policies, but just the transition from high school to college. And their training has definitely prepared them well to start off this year on a really solid foot. So
quite literally on the foot being in track. So a couple of the more experienced people on this team in terms of your throwers and John Kearns and Michael Belcher. John is, one of the top throwers in the conference for quite a long time now. He was first in the hammer throw, fourth in the discus, and then third in the shot put, where Michael was first in the discus, third in the hammer, and 11th also at javelin. Obviously, we kind of know what we're going to get out of those two throwers, but, coming off of, like you said, a two-year break, essentially, how important was it for them to have those solid numbers put up in their first meet back?
Yeah, for them, it was a huge relief, likely. And John, his very first throw, in the hammer after having a delay to, because it is supposed to start on Saturday night, and they made a decision late at night to move it to early Sunday morning, and then right before like his flight was supposed to go, they decided to run a different event during that time. And like with all those like factors into it, with him and Mike, like really stepped up huge. John, very first throw, missed his PR by 0.03, so of a meter, which is just a couple centimeters really. And like to start off the season like that, like, is phenomenal. I said we do expect him to be at the top of the hammer and disc, and like for the shot, and then same with Mike, like we expect him to be at the top of disc and hammer, and like he's working in with javelin this year too to try and squeak out a few more points for us. And I mean, he also threw a PR in the discus with one of his final throws on the day, and his hammer is, I believe, just half a meter short of his PR. So Coach DeMarcus Stitt has done a phenomenal job in the short time that he's had an opportunity to work with these athletes. But to having that senior leadership, like, I mean, I feel like we can score 60 points just between those two at the conference championships.
Yeah, I remember looking at the standings, and those two were second and third in terms of the overall scorers on the men's side, and they were just behind the fantastic thrower from Charleston in his own right. So certainly impressive from them. Going back a little bit to the track events, and Rondell Carlton, who finished second in the triple jump, who I obviously know from my time in high school is that it's one of the most technically difficult events to perform, and certainly a second place finish is very impressive for him in his own right.
Yeah, this once again like another one of our athletes that came out in first outdoor meet. Like for him, this is his first ever college meet. Like he's one of our first year athletes. He opened up with a PR, and I said it's. So despite everything that we've had to deal with this year, like with regards to the pandemic, like and adjustments in training, things like that, like, I mean, our athletes have done phenomenal, and like he's another one that has just kind of picked up the ball as a first year athlete and has stepped up huge for us. And to see him open up the season with a 12.98 in the triple jump is fantastic. And so, like I said, it'll be exciting to see like how he progresses throughout these next several weeks as we approach the conference championships.
And certainly the point that I wanted to bring up is that you have so many of these young athletes that are already, like you said, in their first meet, setting their PRs. And, you know, certainly over the weekend, not the nicest of weather for you guys to come into your first meet, but as the weather gets a little bit nicer and warmer, you guys are able to get outside rather than having to run and jump through the halls here at Court Center, can only improve those times and those performances as a whole on the season. Another one of the technically difficult and something that I know that I personally could never do in the pole vault, and Mark Vaughns and Adam Smith, they went second and third in the pole vault. And I believe the winner for that event was just a fantastic athlete from Glenville State who had a really, really nice run himself. But for those two, obviously going 2 and 3, and I think Mark finished about 0.3 meters ahead of Adam in that event. But how was it for them to kind of push each other in that event and work with one another in the pole vault to get each other to go higher and higher?
Mark, this is his first year ever doing pole vault, so this was his first time competing in that event, and he was working on it over summer. Like we decided to put him in and try him out in it. Like he's also our top 400 meter hurdler and on our 4x4, and like so he's been learning this event like the entire year, working with Coach Gerhold and Adam, who like this is what he specialized in high school. And so it's a good dynamic between the two, because Adam can definitely like give some advice to Mark, like help him out there. Like they both of these two individuals like are constantly uplifting each other and supporting each other like throughout the practices and throughout the competition. And as it was great to see Mark step up and take second in the meet, like his first time ever competing in a pole vault competition. And for Adam, like It was a great start for him too, to start off the year. So I know the conditions for that pole vault event were definitely not ideal because they had it about 7:30, 8 o'clock at night, and I think we're down to like into the low 40s by that point and stuff. So as it does get warmer, like for these outdoor meets, I mean, I think that they can definitely go higher in the pole vault.
And so with Mark, is that something that either you or one of your assistants came up to him and said, hey, you're pretty good as an athlete as a, overall. Do you want to kind of compete in the pole vault? Or did he come to you guys and he said, hey, I want to learn this event?
That was Mark expressing interest in it. Like he was trying it out over the summer, and he talked to Coach Gerhold and Coach Kemp about it. They spoke with me about it, and I'll be honest, like at first I wasn't too keen on it. And I mean, I talked to some other coaches that I know, and because I mean, Mark's fantastic in the 400 hurdles, and I think he's going to be one of the top athletes in the conference for that. And so my main concern was like, is it going to take away from his success in the 400 hurdles? And but I gave in. Like I was like, okay, let's see what he can do. And I mean, he's definitely shown that he does well at it and that he deserves to be in it. And as I'm thrilled to see like the success that he's already having. And I mean, we're only one meet in.
And certainly a step towards becoming such a well-rounded athlete. And another well-rounded athlete, and what some people would say the most well-rounded, is Justin Dunklin in the decathlon, which certainly has, you know, all different types of events that you have to, you know, be prepared for at any given moment. He finished fifth in the decathlon, certainly an impressive performance, and also was second in the high jump and the long jump portions of that event that allowed him to help him into fifth place. What, you know, kind of training and mindset does that take for him to be able to compete so successfully in that event?
It's a huge time commitment because of all the athletes that we have, by working with his schedule, which that's what Coach DeMarcus and Coach Gerhold and Coach Kemp, like they form a schedule for him throughout the week, as well as for our heptathlete Morgan Matthews, and trying to fit in that many events, like that many technical events with between pole vault, high jump, long jump, shot, disc, javelin, like it's a juggling act. And so with the coaches, I mean, they've done a fantastic job setting him up for success. And for him, like so, like making that time commitment, like even on the weekends to come in and get work done, like I paid off like in this first multi, because I don't know how many multis we'll get. Like there's really not a whole lot this year, and so this might be the only one for him before the conference. And to come in and get second place, and this is his first time ever doing the decathlon. Like he did the heptathlon in indoor last year, and added discus and javelin and along with one other event into the mix like for the decathlon. And so like he added like two very technical events with the jab and discus. And so for him to finish second place, and I mean, you touched on it with high jump and long jump were his strong areas. I mean, that's where he's great at as an open athlete. And so that really carried him there. But I said to finish second place in your first decathlon ever, he's definitely going to have success at the conference championships.
And certainly another one where, as we say, is more practice time getting in, where he's just learning these throwing events, which, you know, are kind of the difference maker in terms of you can have really good athletes that run really well, but got to be able to throw as well. So certainly something he can improve on as the season goes on. Want to wrap up with the men's 4x4 team, which finished again in second place. And it seems like you guys were kind of just chasing Charleston almost the entire weekend, and they finished first in that one. But a very impressive time. I believe you guys finished only between a half second and two and a second behind Charleston in that event. But what was it from that team in terms of, you know, you could expect over this weekend where it's your first meet to maybe miss your handoffs or not have your timing exactly down. But for a second place finish, that's certainly something you got to be impressed with as head coach.
Oh yeah, and like we didn't even have our A team out there for it. So the we held out one of our athletes this week that would have been on the 4x4, and who's a big piece of our 4x4 and like somebody that we're going to count on to help take down Charleston in that event. I mean, last year we finished 3 seconds behind Charleston in the indoor championships with a 3:21. And this year we opened up with a 3:26. And just like not far off from where we were last year with it. And I said, like, missing one of our key athletes for it. And so had to juggle the lineup a little bit, insert one of our alternates into the leadoff with Sreko, and I had Clay Washington, who's our senior leader, on the team. Had him in second, and then Mark Vaughn's, coming from 400 hurdles after pole vaulting the previous night, stepping in into that third spot and running a solid leg, and closed it off with another first-year athlete with Nathaniel Messi, and who showed great promise in the fall with the testing that we did. And so I'm confident that when we get to the conference championships and after putting together our A team, and that we're going to be up there with Charleston throughout. And I mean, what the results don't show is we were quite a bit behind Charleston going into the final leg, probably about a good 25 meters or so. When Nathaniel Messi got the baton, he had just passed Charleston's B team. And it's pretty huge gap in between, and he tried to run him down as best he could, and he really closed it down, and it became a close finish, and a lot closer than what it probably should have been with where he got the baton at. So we're excited for him. Another first year athlete that also PR'd in the 200 earlier that day. And we got several leaders on the team, several seniors that are going to graduate this year and move on, that are producing a lot of great points for us. But obviously, with a lot of the first year athletes and returners, young returners that we have, I think we're set up well for the future.
And certainly something that the seniors can kind of pass on the knowledge to those first year athletes can do nothing but help them as they go out throughout the season. And the next one you have coming up, you go to West Virginia University on Saturday for their invitational. And something that, might be lost on people is, coming from Division III and now in really your first outdoor track year in Division II, and these young athletes being able to go to a Division I university and run on a fairly nice track where it's probably the nicest that they'll have run on in their careers. What are you expecting from your team on Saturday to continue a pretty strong start to the season?
Just really focusing on what we need to improve upon. Continue to knock that rust off, find things like that. We may have made some mistakes or things that we can develop from that first meet as we move into the second meet. And I just really work on that, whether it's accelerations out of the blocks, what feet they come out with on the blocks, how they finish in the throws. It's just working on those little things and finding one thing really to focus on and try to improve that and then move on to the next meet. And so, and trying to get good marks because we got to qualify for the conference meet. So set us up for that. But mostly it's just going to be knocking off that rust and seeing where we're at. And then we'll take a couple weeks off before the next meet. But I think they're excited to go to West Virginia. It's our closest one, so we don't have to travel as far. We'll be taking just the sprinters, jumpers, and throwers to it, while cross country goes to the conference championships this weekend at Ogle Bay. So I'm excited to see what those athletes do as well. They've been working hard, and they did run some of the distance events this past weekend, and so just as a tune-up for that meet. But I said it's going to be another busy weekend as we're at a couple different sites and stuff, and so, but I know they're excited. Hopefully some more good weather coming.
It'd be very certainly nice when waking up to this morning in 20 degree weather, and certainly a case where you'd like to be able to have the opportunity to be in two places at once, but obviously only being able to be in one. But we wish all your runners, both in cross country at the championships and also to your track athletes, the best of luck this weekend as well as for the rest of the season. And thank you for taking the time out of your morning to come and talk to us.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it.
Back here on the Bobcast, and we're bringing in football with head coach Delane Fitzgerald. Coats, your team's first game of the season against the Wheeling Cardinals, a team that you beat 42-12 or 13 last year, and now a 27-20 victory that got pretty close there at the end after you guys jumped out to a 20-0 lead. I know we've talked in a little bit over the past couple of days, but what did you see from your guys on Thursday night?
The good thing that we saw was that we were ready to play at game time, and where you said it like it was, exactly like it happened. We were up 20-0 or early in the second quarter and then just didn't finish the game. But what did we see from our players, right, from a negative standpoint? You know, we saw the fact that we were sloppy and undisciplined. The conditioning level's not what we expected to be from our players. And then the personal fouls and stuff after the plays is unacceptable and going to get cleaned up. We really had penalties hurt drives, which is rare for us. We usually get the ball moving and just keep it moving until we get to the end zone. But we had some penalties, false starts, delay of games, unsportsmanlike conduct penalties, holding penalties that derailed drives that would have scored points in a normal situation.
And so kind of want to go into your mindset of, you know, you guys win the toss, you elect to receive the kick, and the first play of the game, it's a drop snap.
Did we win the toss? If we won the toss and took the ball, then I have something else I have to fix. But I was told that the Wheeling Cardinals won the toss. That's what I was told. So I did not know that, but I'll get it fixed if that did happen.
Okay, that could be my mistake as well.
Anytime we win the toss, we're supposed to defer. We like our defense around here, and we play tough, hard-nosed defense, and we want defense on the field first because it usually sets us up with field position.
And so on that first play with the drop snap, what is going through your mind as you see your team on their very first play of this season of dropping that snap immediately and thinking?
Chad, your memory is good. Chad drops a snap from time to time in practice, so he didn't really worry about it. Knew he'd come back and have a couple of good plays after that, and he did.
And so that one big play was on the 3rd and 17. He scrambles out of the pocket off of the pass opportunity and runs for that first down and is able to get on the second effort to stretch that ball over the first down marker. And he kind of is a dual threat with his arm and his legs. We saw a good number of plays with his legs, of course, the touchdown run that he had along with that 3rd and 17. One thing that I wanted to bring up was his link up between graduate transfer Kyle Belak, where those two seem to just have a really good understanding of one another.
Yeah, you mentioned it at the start of what you were saying, and Chad's legs and Chad reading the backside defensive end and his scrambles and stuff really saved us on Thursday night. But he did a nice job throwing the ball, but he did an even better job of running it, and that was good. But helped us on the offensive side. Kyle played well the other night. Kyle played well the way you expect a graduate transfer to play when he gets to your place. You know, they're supposed to make an impact. It's supposed to be a positive impact. And his was, and I think he had 8 catches, 430-some yards. But you're correct. Chad knows where he's at, and when you get the ball to Kyle, he's going to do some good things with him. Now, he's got to keep his emotions in check and no more unsportsmanlike conduct penalties. I'm not letting that one slide because he had one the other night that cost us points. But yeah, Kyle and Chad have a chance to have good senior seasons.
And so another thing of the versatility of Kyle where – you know, he had all the catches for that many yards and the touchdown, which is a pretty nice catch itself. He also had a 7-yard run and almost threw that touchdown pass to Lincoln Akubu for that touchdown where it was probably a matter of inches where it just went over Lincoln's hands. Is that something that you kind of drew up of something that he's shown in practice that you just implemented in the game of using some trickery with him?
Yeah, we like athletes around here, and Kyle's a pretty good athlete. Yeah, and he can catch and run, and he can throw. If Lincoln runs that route, if he runs the route all the way through and doesn't stop, I think he thought he had gotten so far down the field that Kyle couldn't get it there and he stopped running or he eased up some, and then Kyle throws the ball over his head. But those are things that we've got to iron out. And for a first game of the season, we'll get it straight.
And so we talked about a little bit of the offense. I want to switch to the defense, where your defensive line, especially early in the game, was outstanding. In the first half, I believe it was 5 sacks with Carl Igwe and Zach Strand. Wheeling, much the same as you guys, drops their first snap of the game. And the difference between your two teams is that Zach Strand recovers that fumble. Carl Igwe also forced 2 fumbles, and one of them, Ryan Shelton, took it back to the house for a touchdown. But what was so good about your defensive line to start that game that really Wheeling couldn't get anything going in the start?
We're really good up front, and we've got 8 or 9 really good defensive linemen. We've got to get our rotation going a little better. But we played well up front in the first half, in the first quarter. And then in the last 3 quarters, guys, we were probably as bad as we've been up front here in 7 years. Did not play well midway through the second quarter, all the way through the end of the game on the defensive line. We lacked gap integrity. We didn't take on double teams the way you're supposed to. And our pass rush lanes were terrible. So we're just running up the field and not keeping gap integrity and letting them run the football and letting the quarterback scramble. Things we have to fix here. I don't want to be, negative Nelly. But there were more negatives out of that game Thursday night than there were positives. Now, as a head coach, you sit here and smile because you did everything wrong and you're still 1-0, and that's a good life. But you have to get it fixed if you're going to beat a good football team going forward.
And one thing that I know, and certainly with talking with you and so by the way that our offices is, we can kind of overhear some conversations that you have. Not that we're eavesdropping, but it just kind of overhear it. And that you gave a lot of credit to Wheeling. They brought in their first-year quarterback, Jalen Lee, and really kind of sped up their play calling and their actions where your defensive line couldn't get the opportunities with Lee and Sai Ali both kind of running off some run-pass options. Was that something that they brought in that kind of confused you guys or changed things up that made your guys play not as well as you would have liked them to?
They were running zone read and having some success with it. It was because of our lack of discipline in the front seven is why they were having success. We weren't keeping gap integrity. In this interview, I need a dry erase board so I can explain gap integrity and what all that means and all. We just didn't do it. And then they ran quarterback. They were running quarterback follow. And I don't even know if they were running it on purpose now that I see it on film. But it's where the quarterback fakes the ball to the tailback, and then he just follows the tailback up in the hole. They were running some of that, and we hadn't practiced that, hadn't seen it. I don't know if we've seen it 3 times in the last 7 years we've been here. So it was new to us, and they had some success with that. But you got to take your hat off to their coaching staff because their coaching staff did a nice job, and they changed quarterbacks, and the second quarterback did better than the first. And, hey, good little young player, and he's got a bright future with them.
And so you talk about the disciplinary issues, and it was for both teams. Wheeling had 12 penalties for 93 yards. You guys, 15 for 152 yards. And you mentioned that a lot of those were just silly personal foul calls after the play had happened. Is that something that because you guys haven't played in basically a year and a half that, needs to be ironed out, like you said, over the season where, they were just a little bit too hyped up and aggressive to start that game?
You said disciplinary issues. We don't have any disciplinary issues. Just every once in a while, we have some discipline issues on the field. You said disciplinary. It makes me think all the off-the-field stuff, but we don't have much of that. On the field, do I think our guys were excited to play? Absolutely. Absolutely. And we played really good. We did some good things up front on the offensive line. Our offensive line played well enough to win. We did some good things. And then we negated it by the fact that we wanted to talk and do things and get extra hits in and stuff like that after the play. So we ruined some of the good stuff that we did. But do I think some of it was out of excitement? Absolutely. Do I think some of it's out of the lack of discipline, not doing football for the last 15 months? Absolutely. And just to be blunt about it is kids go home during the pandemic. They go home during the summer, go home during Christmas break, and they get involved in that undisciplined mess that happens at home, and then they just bring it back up here.
So you brought up your offensive line, which is a very young unit, and they brought a lot of holes out of the defensive front from Wheeling that allowed Malcolm Facey and Josh Maxwell, who's a transfer from Charleston, in that they have a really good change of pace about them, where Malcolm is very shifty and quick out of the blocks, and Josh is more of kind of a power back that's not afraid to take contact. Neither I'm afraid to take contact, I should say, but Josh certainly is a little bit more power back. Is that something that you guys have worked on throughout the fall preseason and now coming into spring, where using those two in different situations to bring out what's necessary to get the drive going.
Yeah, Josh was the starting running back at Concord the last 2 years. So he's coming to us from Concord, and we've been recruiting Josh since he was a junior in high school. So it seems like we've known him for a long time, and he got a chance to come back home to Maryland and play football, and that's been good. No, you're right. Malcolm might be a little more shifty than Josh, but they're both power backs. They both squat a whole bunch of weight. They're really strong young men. We like those two, and then we have to get Evan Branch into the mix there, because Evan Branch is a change of pace back and going to be really, really good here. But those three into a rotation is going to give us something different than a lot of the teams in this conference.
And so I want to talk now about another fairly young unit in the linebacking core, where you have a lot of talent to replace that you just talked with Matt Ambrose last week about. One guy that I was really impressed with was Dylan Culpin, who was tied for the team high in tackles. He got a sack of his own and came up with a couple of really big run stops on his own to stop some of the wheeling drives when they were trying to get going late. Has he kind of emerged as kind of the feature guy in that core for you guys?
Yeah, that, I wouldn't call him the feature guy. Dylan is one of, if not the smartest young men on our football team. And, you know, his dad's a coach, so he's a coach's kid. And we specialize in coaches' kids around here. That's what we like. But Dylan got his first start the other night and did a nice job. Dylan has to figure out how to get off of blocks, which there were times the other night he didn't do. And Dylan's got to figure out gap integrity, which there was times the other night he didn't do. So we've got to fix those things. But what you understand with Dylan Culpin is you know exactly what you're going to get every day, which is the best that he has, and that's good. Now beside him, Mike Morgan played well, and then Jake Brochard played well. Jake's got to stop freelancing and do what the coaches ask him to do. But Jake's always going to make splash plays. He's been making splash plays here for the last 4 years, and those guys are good. And then they're backed up by a bunch of young, exciting, athletic young men. And Ryan Shelton with the scoop and score. That's second time in my career that a young defensive player scooped and scored in his first ever game. So you always like to walk up to him the following day during conditioning or whatever and tell them that they've reached the pinnacle of their college career in their first game. It's all downhill from here because they're not going to score every day. We had, when I was a head coach at Southern Virginia, we had a young man scoop and scored the first two college games of his career. Created a monster because he never got back there. But anyhow, it's funny to think about and makes me smile. But he's a good player. Trevor Craig's a good player. I'm leaving out some of those young guys. Justin Houston's going to be a good player. I'm leaving out a linebacker or two. But we have, so Billy Walker's going to be a good player. We have some young linebackers that have a really bright future.
You speak about that linebacker depth, and I want to talk a little bit about the secondary, who they weren't necessarily asked to do a ton because of the amount of running that Wheeling did, and their throws were a lot of kind of short slants and letting their receivers catch the ball and try to make plays on their own. There were a couple of deep balls thrown. I remember the one to the back of the end zone where Ryan LaFollette caught one and almost got shoved out of bounds, did great to get his foot in, but the depth also at secondary. One play that stood out to me was towards the end of the game when Wheeling's driving at the end and right before they got into inside the 10-yard line is that Octavius Strong made a great play on his receiver where they were both kind of going for the ball. Octavius just did a great job to deny the ball on that. Is that also a thing with your secondary where the depth there really helps them as well?
Yeah, we have some depth at secondary position, and we've got some guys that are going to get to play this weekend that were banged up, didn't play last Thursday night, and that's a good thing. On Octavius has some potential, but that mental and physical toughness still elude him, which has been tough for us. He's got some things he's got to improve on, but he has enough talent to be good. Stacy Watts is the the incumbent corner that seems to have been there forever for us, and just steady Eddie. He's really, really good day in and day out, night in and night out. Really proud of that young man. And then Akai Anloney on the other side does a nice job. But those are our two starting corners, Akai and Stacy. Both of them have an opportunity to be as good as they want to be at the corner position. Avery's been a safety forever. I think Avery had a bunch of tackles the other night. He got tired and missed some tackles, which is a problem. When you know you're athletic is when you miss two tackles on the same play. In my career, I was never that athletic. If I missed them the first time, they were gone. Because I wasn't athletic enough to get up off the ground and go find him and tackle him again. I wasn't fast enough to get there. He missed two tackles in one play the other night, and he's got to fix that. And then Zach Willett played well in his first start of his career, and and then Zach's filling in for an injured player, but did well the other night. Zach Willett's one of the unsung heroes and maybe one of the MVPs that we had the other night because he's doing all of our long snapping now. 3 months ago, he couldn't long snap worth a fizzle, and now he's our guy and doing a nice job, and we're proud of him for that.
Certainly the versatility. And I believe it was Zach Willett who actually tied with Dylan Colbert for that team high lead in tackles when I looked at the final box score. So we look ahead to this upcoming Saturday, and it's kind of the big one for you guys against Notre Dame out in South Euclid, Ohio. Notre Dame picking up a big victory of their own over the weekend against West Liberty. Is it a game that your guys are really looking forward to considering how it went last year, where you were really amped up and then the result just didn't go your way? And this year it's again kind of the top of the MEC going against one another.
Yeah, well, going to last year's game, you know, we're down one score. I think it was 5 points at halftime. We were down one score going into the fourth quarter, or early in the fourth quarter. We got it back to one score, and then they pulled away from us a little bit late last year. A good football program with a lot of money. They spend a lot of money on recruits that other teams in the conference don't have that opportunity to do. But good football program, and they've been well coached for a long time. Mike Jacobs built a nice program there, and then he turned it over to Coach Mental, and he's going to do a nice job there with them. But on Saturday, it looked like the best team in the country on Saturday. So they were up on West Liberty 63-7 midway through the second quarter, which is what good teams do. It's what we should have done on Thursday night. When you have somebody down 20-0, you put your foot on a throat and you finish it. And if that cliche or that saying is outdated, you have to excuse me. But when you've got an opponent down, you do not let them up off of the ground. And that's what Notre Dame did. It's what we should have done on Thursday night. It's what Notre Dame did on Saturday. That they got West Liberty down and just kept pounding them. The Notre Dame coaching staff did a nice job of not scoring 100 points on Saturday, because they could have scored 100 points really, really easy. And I'll be off a little bit on this. They played 4 or 5 quarterbacks. They did everything they could do not score points at the end of the football game. Good football team. Good football team, going to be a good matchup. Notre Dame doesn't have any holes. So that they don't have any of that. There's no weaknesses. There's no flaws. There's not many holes there.
Certainly one that we'll be excited to watch. Obviously, Matt and I, unfortunately, unable to travel with you guys to call that game, and they're not allowing media due to the pandemic, but certainly
one that... I know you guys are just hating not having to get up at early hours and make that trip. Hey, rough trip. So I'm being told because of the pandemic that we're going to one day the trip, and that's a doozy.
Yeah, certainly. And fortunately, a little bit of reprieve in that you get the 2 o'clock kickoff rather than the 1 o'clock, but certainly a tough trip to go there. But we wish
Brother, just makes you get home later. So it just makes it a longer day.
Well, we wish you certainly the best of luck in that game and going forward for the rest of the season as well. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to come and talk to us on the Bobcast
here. I appreciate you having me. Thank you.
Back here on the Bobcast, and this time we're bringing in field hockey with head coach Caitlin Thompson. Coach, it's your back-to-back week of playing against St. Mary's, doing a home-and-home with your former CAC foes. Lost 2-0, but, you know, I want to start with, what's it like playing a team, you know, just last week, and then, you know, this week you're seeing them right again and nothing really in between?
Yeah, it's definitely different. But, you know, it's nice in the fact that we know what to expect when we're going up against them. So, you know, we knew what corner plays they're going to do. We knew how they played. So it's nice in that aspect. You don't really have to do a lot of scouting because the team just saw them the week before. So,
and so one thing that I noticed, and I listened to a little bit of your Bobcast next week that I don't think brought up, but the fact that you guys have such a young team and 10 first year players compared to St. Mary's, who has a lot of juniors and seniors and sophomores where they're much more experienced. Do you see that kind of playing out on the field for St. Mary's? And I know last week where they scored that goal to tie it up and they really took control after that and you guys kind of shut down. And then this week it really was St. Mary's kind of dominated because of that experience they have. Is that something that you can notice with your players on the field?
Yeah, I mean, we are a young team. Some of the things that we need to work on is our chemistry together. It's not quite flowing for a full 60 minutes. It flows in and out, but it's not full 60. So that is something that we're definitely seeing. We just need our upperclassmen to really step up and try to help take control and It's not happening for a consistent 60 minutes right now. So,
and talk about that 60 minutes. And in that game, it was really all St. Mary's for the first three quarters. You guys had the first opportunity off a corner and couldn't capitalize. And then St. Mary's really had all the opportunities until the fourth quarter. What was it that kind of clicked in the fourth quarter? Was it you going to the team and being like, hey, you know, they've had every single opportunity. What are you guys doing? You guys need to kind of kick it into gear. And then they finally did in that fourth quarter.
Quite frankly, we kind of unloaded our bench in the fourth quarter and had a lot of freshmen playing. And the freshmen really stepped up and in that fourth quarter and really applied the pressure. Ashlyn Cave had a fantastic game the whole time. Zoe Redding came off the bench and had a really great game in the last of the third and fourth quarter. So really saw a lot of people, a lot of freshmen stepping up. Maddie Wallace also came in and really stepped up. So that was great to see from the freshman class.
So certainly, you know, bench giving a spark in any sport that can happen in, and certainly with you guys as well. And so one of the sophomore that I wanted to bring up was your goalkeeper in Madison Mandelanson, who had a couple of big saves in that third quarter to kind of try and keep you guys in it. And this is, you know, the first where she's played the entire game. What have you seen from her as a sophomore, where she played in a couple of spot minutes last year, but this year has really stepped up and trying to be the starter for this team?
Yeah, Madison's a very talented goalkeeper. The only person that's going to hold Madison back is Madison. And I think this week she really did a good job of playing with confidence in practice. And, you know, when we said she was going to be the starter again yesterday, she did a great job of, you know, stepping up to it and really playing with confidence in herself in the warm-up and in the game. So I was really proud of Madison for stepping up, and I thought she had a great game yesterday.
And so another topic, then, it kind of goes along with you guys being a young team. And then the other day that I was talking with your assistant, Nicole Andriani, about some of the young players, and she saw it as this season as a whole, with you guys being an independent, having a tough time trying to schedule people. And she saw it just as a positive of getting to play, in that, you know, these young first-year players can come into college and they can actually get this playing experience, albeit it'll play against D3 teams. But as, you know, both of us know, in the CAC, it doesn't get much easier playing against them. But how much do you see it as a positive for some of these talented first-year players to get college experience and actually get to be able to play, where a lot of other teams don't get to play right now?
Yeah, it's fantastic, because like I said, we're having some connection issues, so we're kind of working through those issues right now, which is great. Like, obviously, do I wish we weren't having these connection issues? Of course. But it's nice that we can really work it out. And it's tough to just see at practice what the real issues are. Your real issues are really going to come out in a game, because that's when the pressure's on. That's when, you know, everything really comes down to it. So it's been nice to kind of see where the disconnect is in the game, so that we can work on it now and be prepared, you know, keep preparing ourselves in the spring, so that way in the fall it looks better and better. But yeah, it's great getting these freshmen, this freshman class, this playing experience, because they are such strong field hockey players. So it's been great to kind of watch them evolve.
And so something that I just kind of brought up, but something that I know from my time of going to York College in PA, and certainly knowing you guys as a team, and then also the rest of the CAC as well, and that, you know, I brought it up that I know that they're not any step down from Division II. back here on the Bobcast this week, and we are bringing in baseball with head coach Anthony Williams. Coach, finally got to pick up your first wins of the season on the road at IUP on Saturday. Fell in the doubleheader in a couple of good games at Slippery Rock as well. But what did you overall make of your weekend, where it was a pretty long couple of days for your guys?
Yeah, it sure was. I think, first of all, it was just good to get the first win out of the way, certainly after giving away a couple against Kutztown in the opening weekend. But it was nice to see the guys get the result that I think we felt like we were, you know, close to getting the weekend before. So, you know, we had a decent week of practice. We had some good weather. We were able to get outside and get some things cleaned up that we needed to. And certainly from the offensive side, the guys came ready to swing the bats this weekend, put up some numbers. So we were able to go take care of business against IUP and played in a couple really close games, showed a lot of grit in the doubleheader losses to Slippery Rock. Learned a lot this weekend, probably a little bit more so than we did the previous weekend, and excited to get this thing moving in the Mountain East play.
And so we'll start off with that first game of the weekend and your first win in 10-8 against IUP, and Josh Kalapower kind of pitched the lights out. It was 5 2/3 inning with just 2 hits allowed. And I know that you've been talking with Matt Ambrose in your first weekend against Kutztown of how impressed you've been with him. But what did you see specifically from that game that allowed him to be so successful?
Well, I'll say the one thing about Kali on Saturday against IUP, he just competed without his best stuff, and I think that was nice to see. I thought his stuff was actually better against Kutztown the week before, or at least the ball was coming out of the hand a little bit better. He did have his curveball against IUP and was able to mix and match, get himself out of jams when he did. So I was proud of his performance there. I think that it's always important to be able to compete and find a way to win when you aren't really on top of your game or don't have your best fastball that day, so to speak. So Kali did that for us.
And so going into the kind of the story of that game, where you guys had a pretty nice lead up until the seventh inning, and you guys scored actually a couple of runs in the top of the seventh that ended up being pretty important, where IUP came back to all the way within 2. I think they scored 7 runs in that seventh inning. And you know, how was it to see, you know, your guys after those losses against Kutztown, where you had those opportunities and you're thinking, oh my God, here we go again against IUP?
Yeah, I think coming off the first weekend against Kutztown, where we blew a couple leads, had some issues in the bullpen, we knew that we wanted to continue to put up runs. So even in the top of the seventh there, when we had a pretty comfortable lead, I think we were up 8-1. We still executed a little bit of small ball. We executed a hit and run, go first to third, moved some guys in, manufactured a couple runs there and scratched a few across, as you mentioned. They kind of loomed large there and making it 10-1. And those extra tallies there in that seventh played a big part in what would happen later. So really windy weekend. The wind was blowing both days. Kind of all over the place. So there were some challenges for outfielders and infielders on any ball in the air. And, you know, we had some issues in the bottom of the seventh. Some walks hurt us, and then some misplays in on defense, balls that I think, should have been caught, or plays that should have been made, just didn't kind of go our way. A little bit wind-aided, a little bit of lack of focus. And fortunately, we were able to come in, and Nate Vermillion came in and closed out the game by getting a game-ending 6-4-3 double play to kind of let everybody relax a little bit. It certainly wasn't very clean or, smooth victory there by almost nearly blowing a 10-1 lead there in the seventh. So, but we challenged the guys in between games. We kind of laid out the expectation there of what we wanted to do, and the guys definitely responded in the second one.
And so in that second game, really, really the offense came to life with a 20-3 blowout victory. And the offense really was the story of that. It was 1-1 in the early goings, but then the third and fourth innings, you tack on 4 runs. And the fifth, the big inning where you put up an 8 spot against IUP. What was it that, you know, the offense finally, everything kind of clicked at once in that game?
Yeah, we definitely had a lot of extra base hits, and we had a few long balls this weekend. I know Bryce Jackson had a couple, Drew Smith had a couple. But more importantly, I think it was just consistent quality at-bats, just guys continuing to not give at-bats away. Even when we got up big, you know, we're just continuing to stay with our approach. You know, and some guys are guys that are power guys. Some guys are the, you know, more of a scrappy guy that's going to put the ball in play. So we, you know, one of our offensive philosophies is applying pressure, and we really can't do that if we're striking out a bunch. So that's one of the things we're really trying to emphasize is cutting down on strikeouts, putting balls in play, and especially when you have a windy weekend of games, you know, you got to be able to put balls in play to force the defense to make plays behind you.
And so, and you just kind of brought him up a little bit, but Andrew Smith, who kind of put the cherry on top of that victory with a 3-run homer that got you guys to that 20th run. And then the next day, he also pitched 2 scoreless innings himself. Is that something that he's kind of bringing to the team in terms of his versatility, in terms of being a big bat to bring in and also being able to kind of pitch spot or spot pitch in a couple scenarios?
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of what Drew's here to do and swing the bat. And we felt comfortable with him on the mound. He had a really good winter, looked really good. Had a rough first outing at Kutztown with the blown save on opening day. But we wanted to get him back out there and give him an opportunity to kind of, you know, carry on what he was doing this winter. And he certainly looked the part on Sunday against Slippery Rock. But, you know, Drew's a big left-handed bat, can hit for power. And he put that on display a little bit this weekend. And he's going to be capable of getting a lot of outs for us, and was proud of him being able to bounce back and do that for us.
And so we move into Sunday against Slippery Rock. In the first game, it was an 8-5 loss where, you know, not necessarily a back-and-forth game as the score would suggest, where Slippery Rock kind of had a lead throughout that they kind of maintained and you guys just couldn't get back in. Was it just a scenario of you just couldn't get that right hit at the right time?
Yeah, we talked a little bit after the first game against Slippery Rock. It was a good game. We lost 8-5, but it was really – just a matter of timely hitting. I think we either out hit them or it was tied in hits in that game. They just had, you know, like I said, better timely hitting. We left a bunch of guys on base. We had, you know, bases loaded a couple times, let them off the hook a little bit. But that's baseball. I mean, we played a pretty clean game. You know, I thought Hayden Ford, he competed, he did well, making his second career start kind of back home near his hometown there. He's from Western PA guy. He did a good job. You know, he kept the ball down. You know, I know they touched them for a few runs, but they're a good offense. They had some timely hits, as they said, and you know, we just got to tip your caps. Just got beat. You know, they executed better than we did on the offensive side in the first game.
And so, kind of the big story of the weekend was that 13-12 loss in extra innings in the second game on Sunday. You go into the sixth inning down 10-1, and somehow the game ends up 12-12 by the end of the seventh inning. You guys actually took the lead at the top of the seventh. But what were you saying to your guys, where baseball's kind of a unique sport in which, you know, in a soccer game, if you're down 10-1, you're not going to come back and win that game under almost any circumstance, where in baseball you have an opportunity basically any single inning to put up a big number. What was your message to the guys where you're down by that much?
I think it was just trying to string quality at bats together, just one at a time, not chasing runs, not looking up at the scoreboard, just that focus of just, hey, one quality at bat at a time. Because, you know, like you mentioned, in baseball, things are contagious. And we saw it on Saturday in game one against IUP. We were on the other side of it where we had a 10-1 lead in the last inning and we gave it up almost because of, you know, just the energy on the other side. At that point in the game, you have nothing to lose. So everybody's kind of relaxed and just kind of, you could see it in the IUP dugout when they were staging their comeback. They were just letting every miscue or every walk kind of fuel their fire. And that sort of momentum, it starts to snowball and it becomes difficult to stop sometimes. So that's where you need a guy when you're on the defensive side of it. You need a guy to make that play or make that big pitch to kind of just stop the bleeding, so to speak. You know, and then on the offensive side, you just try to ride the wave. You know, you just try to ride the wave because it's contagious. It was a crazy game, definitely one of the more wild ones I've been a part of. We had got to the point by being down so much that we had put, you know, Jack Maruskin in, who was in right field on the mound, and we were down 10-1, and now that eliminated the designated hitter, which meant we got the game close back to like 10-8, and we brought in our you know, guy at the back end there who's kind of been our closer now, Nate Vermillion, and so Nate come in the game and kept it at that score, and then, you know, wouldn't you know, we stage another comeback there and take the lead in the seventh, and that means that designated hitter is no longer available to us, and Nate Vermillion actually has to come to bat, which is a scenario that I don't think any of us on the coaching staff would have guessed we would have gotten to. But that sort of energized the team, just getting that opportunity to see a pitcher who doesn't typically bat come up there in that spot. We actually took the lead on a pass ball, so you know, we didn't really, I guess, really need Nate to do much there. But we wanted to make sure we had him on the mound to try to close it out. Unfortunately, we didn't get it done. You know, they tied it in the bottom half of the seventh. We go to extra innings and we get set down in order, I believe, and they ended up walking it off on us. Definitely a wild one, but I think you know, just to reemphasize the grittiness that this team has shown. Doing that on opening day against Kutztown when we fell behind after blowing a lead and battling back, and then to do it again on a bigger level, being down 10-1. So I think it just goes to show that, like you said, in baseball, anything can happen, and our guys are going to play, you know, whether it's 7 or 9 innings, we're going to play all 21 or all 27 outs, and the guys certainly bought into that.
And the story you told about Nate kind of brings me back. I remember as a kid, I was watching, I remember Mariano Rivera, I think in the World Series, had to come to bat. He actually drew a walk in that game, in a pretty important game, because he had to pitch the bottom half of that inning. And sometimes, you know, pitchers just kind of have to do it all. And,
yeah. When we ended up playing a little bit of National League Baseball there with double switching, and actually got Nate into the 9 spot. So we were hoping that spot wouldn't come up again. He was actually 9 batters away. So, but when we staged such a big comeback, his spot came up, and you want that guy on the mound, just like you said with Mariano Rivera. You don't want that guy not pitching, right? So you're gonna let him get to bat and do what you got to do sometimes. So
a couple of guys that I wanted to bring up, and you first brought up Jack Maruskin, who went 8 for 16, 3 doubles, 2 triples, and 7 RBI, and also threw 2/3 of an inning himself. But you know, certainly one of the best weekends that we've seen here in quite a while from Jack, and what allowed him to hit for so much. In terms of power, not, you know, hitting home runs, but his speed on the bases and getting the ball into the right positions.
Jack's just, he's a tough kid. He's a tough kid. He doesn't get affected by weather or just circumstances. And, you know, he had a pretty decent opening weekend against Kutztown. We've had some injuries. We had to juggle the lineup a little bit. So we wanted to give him a shot in the 2-hole to just continue to try to put the bat on the ball. He hasn't punched out very much. He's been putting the ball in play. And put the ball in play hard. So, you know, he certainly did that this weekend. He's been all over fastballs, and he's been learning how to foul off good pitches and give himself other pitches to hit, make, you know, put the pressure on the pitcher. So Jack did a great job. He had a ton of extra base hits, a bunch of doubles against IEP, a couple triples, and just brought a lot of energy, man. Just the kid's a tough guy and plays the game hard. He's fun to watch.
And so another guy that I wanted to bring up, and a guy who this team isn't necessarily built around power. It's not going to be a ton of home run hitting like we would see back in the CAC with CNU, where basically any one of their guys can hit the ball out of the park at any given moment. But Bryce Jackson, who hit, you know, 7 for 16, got a couple of home runs and 7 RBI himself, where, you know, you kind of look at him and you wouldn't necessarily think, you know, this guy can easily hit the ball out of the park like you might think with a guy like Ryan Rohl, who certainly is built more as a power hitter. But what did you see from Bryce that was able to make him so successful?
Well, I think if you come down to practice and say that to Bryce, he would have a different opinion. You know, he routinely puts balls out down towards the football stadium in batting practice. But, you know, he's a guy that we rely on for extra base hits. You know, he hits a lot of doubles. Back when I had him at Clarion a few years back, I think he set the single season record for doubles at Clarion. You know, so we know he's a guy that's going to hit the ball in the gaps at least. And, you know, he's doing a good job of, you know, displaying a little bit of power here this season. He's off to a good start. He actually had a 3rd homer on the weekend. That game, he hit one against IEP previously in the game, or earlier in the game, I should say. He hit one that hit a tree and dropped down. Umpires thought it landed short and rolled underneath of the fence for some reason. So they ruled it a ground rule double, even though the center fielder was out there kind of doing the home run sign. They overturned the call and gave him a double. So he kind of got robbed on one there. But, you know, Bryce has been pretty consistent from the start of the season, which is good. I know he wanted to get off to a good start this season, and he's certainly done that. He's an older guy, so he has some experience, and the guys kind of look to him. And that middle of the lineup is that 2, 3, 4, 5. Those guys have really, really carried us this weekend. And, you know, like I said, it was contagious.
Certainly a scenario where you'd like to have instant replay in Division II, although that's probably several years away, but certainly a call that you'd like to have back. So this weekend, you finally get to play in the MEC for the first time as a Division II program, obviously last year with the season being cut short. Just about to start MEC play, and obviously the pandemic put a halt to that. But you get to play West Virginia Wesleyan on Saturday, DNE on Sunday, both of those doubleheaders that are away games. So it's another big weekend for you guys with the back-to-back doubleheaders, obviously, in this crazy kind of compact but elongated MEC schedule. And you know, what are you expecting from your guys over this weekend to finally see MEC play for the first time?
Yeah, I think our guys are going to be ready to go. Like you said, it's our very first weekend of Mountain East play. We were ready to go last year at this time when we got the news that we were shut down. So I think the returners at least have that on their mind a little bit. But, you know, it's going to be the first time out for Wesleyan and D&E. So I know they're going to be excited to play, you know, especially on Saturday against West Virginia Wesleyan. I mean, opening day is a special day. The energy is never higher than opening day. So we're going to have to be aware of that, you know, that those guys are going to be amped up and juiced up and ready to go. But we also know we got to put pressure on a team that hasn't played. It hasn't been on a field probably very much. So it should be exciting. We're certainly looking forward to a good week of practice here to get ready. We're actually going to make the most of this off day here today. We got some guys that are a little sore, beat up a lot. You know, it was a long weekend. It was cold, windy, you know, and playing four games in 2 days. So, but we understand that that's what it's going to be required this weekend. And from here on out really is the four game sets. And then this weekend's going to pretty much mimic what we just did this weekend, you know, going on the road, playing two on the road, staying overnight, playing two the next day, and being able to put 28 innings together, four games. And our guys understood that going into this past weekend, that was kind of almost like a dress rehearsal in some ways to get prepared for Mountain East play and how the schedule was going to set up. So I think we're prepared for that. At least we know what to expect. You know, I think the guys are going to be hungry. And I believe these eight non-conference games that we got, the NCAA gave us 40 this year, and we have 32 Mountain East games. So we had eight non-conference to use. And I think we use those eight to challenge ourselves competition-wise, to get ourselves prepared, to get ourselves ready. And I think that we did that, and we'll be certainly ready to go on Saturday.
Certainly one thing that the MEC can expect from your guys is they're going to be competitive no matter what the scoreline is. And you know, as we've seen, you know, you guys are going to make it a game no matter where you guys are. So we thank you for taking the time out of your morning here on your off day to come and speak to us on the Bobcast. And we wish you the best of luck for this weekend and the rest of the season.
Thanks, Logan. Appreciate it.
Back here with the Bobcast, and we're bringing in women's soccer with head coach Brian Parker. And coach, over the weekend, you had just kind of one of those soccer games where you dominate the possession, you create a lot of chances, and somehow it ends in a 1-1 draw against Alderson Broadus. What did you make of your team's performance with, you know, the big stat line that people brought up to me with 45 shots and 14 of them on goal, but still just only able to come away with the 1-1 draw?
Yeah, it was quite, obviously emotionally it felt a little disappointing at the end because we certainly created a good enough number of chances to have scored. But it happens. You know, if you want to win games, you have to have the ball. First of all, we had the ball plenty. You want to create chances to score, and we certainly created plenty of chances. Sometimes it just feels like there's a cover on the goal and you're just not going to cash in sometimes. You know, we've had games where we've shot four or five times and scored a couple, and to get 45 opportunities and only score the one goal. It's a learning experience. It's growth. I was just trying to be calm and supportive and be positive. I mean, a lot of it, of course, look, how many times have you seen a basketball player go 0 for 12 and then the 13th shot is the game winner? So we were in it right till the very end. The last second chance in the game was a fantastic one, actually. I'm actually pretty happy that we really poured it on. Obviously, their fatigue was settling in. They didn't have the numbers they expected. And so good game, you know, good credit to them. Good game plan for them. Keeper had a great game, and we'll learn from it.
And so you talked about Alderson Broadus' game plan. And what was sort of the game plan for you guys having AB hasn't played yet this season? You haven't played them, obviously, just moving up to Division II. You're playing in your second year, and with a team that hasn't played and you haven't played against, what's kind of your plan of going into it without having known really anything about them?
So that's all, you know, was really true of all three of our games. You know, this year we hadn't really gotten film on anybody going into any of these games just because of the circumstances we were in. So I think the bottom line is we train our team to problem solve, you know, what's on in the game, you know. You know, how high is their back line? What, you know, what are the matchups like? I mean, are there, you know, how, you know, there's certain questions we have kind of trained ourselves as coaches to go through to evaluate what they're doing, how it matches up with what we're doing, and then try to process what's the best way to get chances. And so obviously, you know, any kind of over the top early ball was clearly not on in that game, you know, the way they just kept their defense kind of shelled in there and had lots of bodies in the center of the field. We weren't going to use any kind of ticky-tack passing combinations to break it because it was just so crowded in there, although we certainly tried that an awful lot. So we had to go wide and use the flanks and get our numbers wide and use a little bit of pace and whip in lots of crosses. And, you know, once we settled into realizing that that was where, you know, the game was sort of on for us, we'd had a lot of success. I mean, we just tore up that left flank in the whole second half, you know, with – you know, Chu first and then Lexi Pate. So, you know, a little more preparation on that flank play game and how to sort of get around the teams as opposed to getting through them is obviously on the agenda for this week. But, you know, it's just interesting. You know, that's what's so great about the game is we played three different teams that had all three different styles and approached us very different ways. And so, you know, that problem solving mentality to have confidence in what you're seeing, trust each other and trust your coaches and just try to execute the right kinds of ideas is what it's all about. You know, I watched the video obviously at length and we did tons of good things in that game. We really did. And so I'm not unhappy. Thank God we got the goal. I mean, obviously giving away all 3 points would have been awful. So we did get the point and got the draw and you know, I'll take 45 shots anytime.
And you brought up Lexi Pate. I wanted to bring up something that I was really impressed with calling the game in the first half was the link-up play that she brought with Audra Kern. Audra obviously starting the game in the center forward, Lexi starting out on the right wing, but Lexi would come inside and Audra would kind of come and receive the ball and then would link up with Lexi. And I remember one specific play right at the top of the box, ball came into Lexi. Audra was making a run off her, got it into her and fired a shot that goalkeeper again made a nice save on her. But has that been something that you've seen all season? Obviously those two linked up in the first game against D&E with a cross, a shot from Audra turning into a Lexi Pate goal. But those two, have you seen them kind of linking up specifically with each other throughout this season?
There's no question that is by design and also an expectation I think we have, because Pate is going to get the end line a lot. She's going to get to the end line by going around defenders and just doing it with her pace and quality. And sometimes, you know, when that gets cut off, she's going to bring the ball inside and be a threat to get shots off herself and then look to combine in a little tighter space in the center of the field. And she did a little bit of both of those. She got to the end line a lot. And of course, your center forward, whoever that is certainly going to be a target. I think we probably, you know, I think if there's anything I would say just about the specifics on the ball, it's just to be a little more deceptive. I think that we were a little bit predictable, especially when we were shooting. I mean, we probably had more shots blocked than maybe their goalkeeper saved in the game. I don't know that number, but you know, certainly saw tons of sort of early shots, you know, when we could have maybe been a little bit sort of deceptive, kind of resetting that shot and getting a little better quality shot. But then, of course, we overpassed a little bit too sometimes and tried to make it look a little bit too pretty. So I was happy with the variety we showed, but obviously that flank play action with Pate is certainly going to be a common thing.
And so with AB, obviously they were low on numbers. They only had a couple of substitutes to choose from. Their plan was clearly to play on the counterattack, and they had a really good player to do that with Gwen Sherwood, who's a first-year player for them, who brought a ton of pace to their team and often was the only player up front. So AB scores that goal. It's off of your own corner kick. They clear it away. Gwen picks the ball up on the halfway line and just kind of sprints past one of your best defenders in Mackenzie Fulch and finds a really nice finish into the corner. And it was a little bit ironic. We had talked before the game of you guys were expecting a win, as you expect to win almost all your games this year. And your one worry was that, much like you talked about West Virginia State, they have a really fast forward that got a hat trick the other week, and that kind of just happened to you guys, where a really fast forward got one chance and she took it.
Yeah, and again, credit to them. You know, I think that, you know, what we say almost every week is that every team on our schedule, I mean, probably down to, this is true of probably U10 soccer, you know, everyone has a speedy forward. There's a reason that they're a forward. probably because they are speedy. And then everyone has a player that can thump a ball at them, you know, in their direction and give them a chance. And so we just didn't know which player it was exactly right away. And as we learned, of course, after that opportunity, we cut that out pretty smartly. And I thought we handled her very well for the duration of the match. But she got the one good chance, and we kind of underplayed it, so to speak, gave her a little bit too much room. And, you know, credit to her. She used a nice burst of pace and a quality finish. And that's not a surprise to see that happen. Obviously, still disappointing because it was against the run of play. And, you know, we are putting some players forward who are good in the air on corners. And we did get kind of caught. No doubt about that. Obviously, if I'm sitting here talking to you and she did it a second or third time, I'd have a very different attitude about it. But we did a great job of kind of fronting her and getting in her back and getting some early pressure and just kind of, you know, really preventing her from facing up. I think she did have a couple more chances maybe as the match wore on, but there's no question that we adapted pretty quickly to that. But again, credit to her. I would not have done anything very differently if I was the AB coach and had that kind of pacey kid up front and was sort of playing a defend and counter style. I mean, we may do it this year before it's all said and done. So, like I said, I appreciate their preparation. It just makes everybody better, makes for better games.
And so you talked about, you know, finally getting that goal, and then certainly one that was important in the end to avoid dropping that game as a whole and piling on pressure throughout the half, and it finally paid off. You guys had a lot of corners, and it was finally one from Leela Clark on the far side, kind of floated in a ball to the back post, and someone that you certainly wouldn't expect to get a headed goal in Tony Fiacco-Miser at the back post was just unmarked as a whole and got the open header. But how important was it for you guys to get that goal with about 8 minutes left in that first half?
Well, of course, we are happy we got it when we did, you know, before the halftime. And when you get into that 1-0 game, or even as we did in the 1-1 game, you know, as the game progresses, you start to kind of think there's a destiny about the outcome sometimes, but you're kind of, you know, fighting that, you know, you're always sort of realizing that you can change the game even at the last second if you need to. And we've been involved in plenty of last second, you know, goals on, you know, for and against us over the years. And, you know, it would have been nice to have one, but I think the point is that the timing was real good and enabled us to just have a tremendous amount of momentum and confidence in the second half. And, you know, I joke with Tony, and she's our target now on free kicks, right? She's 5'2", maybe. But, you know, winning high balls is so much about attitude and just courage. And obviously, tracking that flighted ball is not the easiest thing in the world. And so she tracked it smartly and, you know, expect the ball. We always say that. Expect good things to happen when you're a striker in front of the opposing goal. And she was not surprised when that ball landed on her head and just nodded it in. So again, credit to her ability, and it's a big reason why we, you know, played her a little higher in a little higher position in the second half.
Yeah, I believe she had the most shots in terms of any player on your team in that game, and I want to kind of go back to the goal and in terms of Tony scoring and in that, and, you know, I was commentating the game. It took me about 10 or 15 seconds to figure out who scored it because I certainly wasn't expecting her to be the one to nod that in the back post, but it was great anticipation and certainly a goal that any goal scorer would be proud of. One player that I wanted to bring up that might not get a ton of attention in terms of if you're just looking at the final stat sheet, but Hannah Thompson, who's playing in that number six role as the holding midfielder, her energy and her drive that she brings from the midfield, especially coming in as a first-year player into this team and kind of fitting in seamlessly, connecting the back four into the attack, has played every single minute of every game this season. Certainly a player who, with her energy levels, you don't need to bring her off. What's been her success so far? Where we know that she has a pretty good shot and that she can get forward more, but being that link-up play between defense and the rest of the attack.
So she's been terrific, of course, since she arrived. I mean, her and Caroline came a year early, or a semester early, really. So they were actually here halfway through their senior year a year ago. So they got through our sort of indoor segment of our season before the COVID shutdown. But, you know, they don't feel like they're new players at all, especially after the fall. You know, like I said before, we had an 8-week preseason in the fall and really got to integrate them, and they've been awesome. she just gravitates to that deeper position, you know, and she's good in the air and she's got great stamina. We did some fitness testing and she's winning races. You know, her fitness is as high as anyone on the team. So her athleticism and energy and fitness is not a consideration. I would, you know, normally want to spell those kids a little bit as the second half wears on when we have the reentry opportunity, but she didn't really need that. And she's great, like I said, defensively, but she does have a really nice final pass where she can lift that ball into really good spaces, and she's just a calm and composed player. So, you know, again, I've seen her for years. I happen to know her very well, and her club team is terrific, and she's had great high school experiences and was also a basketball player. So she has a good insight to sort of the team game and how to react to teammates and things. So yeah, I couldn't be happier with her. I think she's been great. Obviously, we have other players who like that deeper position. Like, you wouldn't even know that Caroline Burton was a six, with, you know, when she arrived, because she's just flying around, you know, covering more mileage than anybody on the team. But I think Hannah, is just a little more comfortable keeping things in front of her, and I love how the center backs communicate really well with her, and she helps double team and cut things out. Does a lot of those, like you kind of alluded to, a lot of those. Things that aren't in the stat line, you know, like a double team when you go put a tackle in on the striker behind you, you know, those kinds of things. She does that stuff all the time, but, you know, she's going to be very good.
And certainly you know, looking from the outside, you would not expect a midfield three with Hannah and Caroline and Tony to be such young players playing in this team. It looks like they're juniors and seniors at this point with how they interact with each other. One thing that I wanted to bring up, especially towards the end of the game, the second half and both overtimes, was, and we talked about AB's tactics in that they were essentially playing with a back six in a way, and it could be a back eight, where they had obviously their back four. They would bring in their two holding players to come in and essentially play in the center defense with them, and then their two wides would also push back when your fullbacks were going forward. But how do you deal with that much defensive mindset, where you said you can't really play the tiki-taka passing around them, you can't get in behind them? What's the strategy to break that defensive wall down?
Well, like I said, it becomes a flying play game. You know, we have to get wide. We have to get wide and get around them. And so once we started to really, you know, I guess one of the things you may have saw is we just had to be a lot more expansive and just use every inch of the width we had, you know, was available to us in the second half. And so we got our wide forwards really wide and used our wide backs. And there was a lot of just, you know, our wide back just handing it over to the striker, you know, playing, you know, Lexi paid in some space and letting her get around the corner. They weren't even out wide very much in the second half. So on that left flank especially, we were just getting to the corner of the box and getting crosses in all the time. So, again, that's probably not something, you know, we have rehearsed as well as the, you know, other ways that you might, you know, be a counterattack team yourself, or just try to really use your quality on the ball to allow your ball speed and combination play to break teams down. So it took us maybe a little while to realize, hey, these balls aren't working in the center of their defense, right? Let's get out wide and let's kind of get them turned a little bit, you know, toward their own goals. We get to the end line and try to create some things. And we did that. Again, a lot of it is really just having, us asking the right questions and getting the tactics right and giving the players ideas, but of course making sure they process it and understand it and can share it, and there's leaders out there and voices who get it. So we did a great job. You know, Leela Clark is the other mid who we played she played every minute when we moved Tony to forward, and she was busy and athletic and getting out wide and helping get numbers around the ball. So, you know, like I said, a lot of good things we take from the game. But you record the goals. You don't count passes and win games with passes. But with the building blocks are there, and overall, we did a lot of great things.
Certainly, if you counted passes as the winning formation or the winning statistics, certainly those Barcelona teams back in the late 2000s would have won every single game, and it wouldn't have been close.
Well, you know, they say soccer is like one of the cruelest sports, you know, because you can do so many things right and just not win on the scoreboard. And we've been a part of that on both ends. And I'm sure that, you know, I would love to win a big game when we get outshot by some margin later this year. It might happen, so we'll see.
So your next game coming up, you'll travel out to that kind of mid portion between Ohio and West Virginia in going to Wheeling, a team that you beat pretty heavily last year. But this year, in looking at some of their results, they're a lot more defensively solid in terms of they look like they're playing better. So what are you expecting from your team on Friday as you travel to, you know, with some of the older players, they might remember, hey, we beat this team last year. We might be able to take it a little bit easy in terms of getting their mentality right, where you can't take any team easy in this conference.
No, I think the mental reset is a big part of it, and just approaching. I mean, of course, after this kind of a result, you would expect the hunger, you know, our appetite should be just fine in training this week and whatnot. So I think we'll be okay, and we'll recover from it. No doubt that Wheeling, it was in a rebuild process, and probably, you know, perhaps even benefited from the extra time this year to build their roster. And they do look feisty and physical, and have some athletes, and we've seen a little bit of the film, but of course we'll break more of that down and try to, you know, not be as surprised, you know, at least initially in the game as maybe we were against AV. But you know, it is what it is. You just got to go out and execute. And I think every team's desire is to obviously have the ball enough to make teams adapt to what you're doing, as rather than vice versa. So that'll certainly be our goal on Friday as well.
All right. Well, we thank you for taking the time out of your morning to come and talk to us here on the Bobcast. We wish you the best of luck on Friday, hoping to keep your undefeated streak to start this season going.
I like that word. I appreciate that. But let's not jinx anybody. We want to stay away from that from now on. I appreciate it. Thanks for your time.
Wrapping up the Bobcast this week, we have men's soccer with head coach Keith Burns. Coach, your team pulling out a 3-1 win in the end, facing off against a 10-man Alderson Broadus team who had a player sent off. It was your first time seeing AB in Division II, a team that hasn't played yet due to COVID issues within their athletic department, and obviously having not played them last year. So what was it like to go into this game without knowing really anything about your opponent?
I think in situations like that, you just really focus on yourself and the things that we wanted to fix from our previous game. And then obviously once we get a better look at what they're doing and what shape they have, we can make adjustments. But yeah, we focused more on ourselves and where we just thought we fell short against Concord and how we could be better. And then once we got into the match, then we figured out what formation they were in and kind of their style of play, then we, you know, at halftime, I thought we made some decent adjustments.
And so starting out the game, you guys are pretty banged up, a couple injuries, especially in your front line. You had Malik Shadid starting up front as your striker, with Vaughn Phillips still kind of trying to recover from his injury. And also, one thing that I noticed watching the live stream is that you had Gage Adams starting in at center mid instead of his usual position at center back. So, you know, is it kind of putting a square peg into a round hole with those guys, or are they guys that you can trust to go in and do those jobs that they're asked of them?
Well, Gage played the six for us all last year, so it wasn't too much of a stretch. It was just we have a plethora of center backs, and we were running out of forwards, so kind of had to move everybody up a little bit with the injuries. And Malik's been training hard at that role. He's just kind of been one of the reserve players to come in and give minutes to Randy and Tamino and Vaughn. And with all those guys carrying injuries, you know, it was his chance to kind of show what he could do.
And so early on, it's kind of a back and forth to start out the game, but you guys capitalize early up, or a poor back pass from one of the battlers' center backs back to the goalkeeper. And Will McComber is a guy who kind of just seems to always be in that right place to be where he's needed. And he had a nice, tidy finish beyond the battler goalkeeper. And we talked about Will a couple weeks ago after the Wheeling game. And again, in this game, he just finds a way to be in the right position when he needs to be. And it's not just like, you know, he gets lucky, but he knows where on the field he can be to make an impact. Is that something that you see as well?
Yeah, I mean, he plays to his strengths, and his strengths are, you know, his smarts and his soccer IQ, and also just kind of his work rate and where he needs to be. And like I said, it's not kind of luck. He reads the game well, so he can kind of position himself offensively and defensively into good positions, you know, to get to a loose ball like that, or to, you know, block a passing lane. So, yeah, I think the soccer IQ definitely is one of his strengths.
So right after that goal, you, on your own, give up your own goal, where it's another back pass that just didn't have enough pace on it, and AB came in and scored on their own. Was that kind of a bit of a wake up for you guys, where, you know, you score that early on and then you immediately concede, to be like, okay, well, we need to step it up again now after falling back and maybe being a little bit complacent after scoring?
Yeah, I mean, it's the old adage of, you know, the first and 5 minutes of the half and after a goal is scored is when you're most vulnerable. And yeah, we just weren't, didn't play with enough, you know, kind of intensity at that time. Kind of, oh, we got a goal, and all of a sudden we got lazy and did the same thing they did, just missed a back pass, and they walked onto the end of it and put it in the back of the net. So, yeah, I mean, it makes us go, all right, well, we got to start over again and kind of find the switch to get going forward, and this game is not over.
And so what ended up being really the difference in the game was two goals from Daniel Jurassic, who, you know, not much of a goal scorer early in the season. He's kind of a guy that I look as kind of a link up in midfield, where he can transition the defense into attack and receive the ball from the center backs and go forward into the forwards. But in this game, he certainly showed off his finishing with a couple of really nice, well-taken goals. Is that something that he's kind of added as he's gone through with this team, or is it something that he's always had and he's just now showing it off for everyone to see?
No, well, we see it all the time in training. We just wanted him to do more of it in the games. Yeah, I mean, those finishes are not atypical for what he does on the practice pitch. So the goal is to get him closer to the net, get him in positions to get his shot off, because he can go right and left, and you know, just his finesse, really, to kind of find where it needs to go. Just find the back of the net is something we want. We want the ball at his feet, basically.
And so something that people might point to as a turning point, which, you know, the game didn't change a whole lot in terms of how both teams were playing. Obviously, the red card at the very end of that first half, where AB came out in the second half and they still were just coming at you guys. They weren't, you know, holding back and trying to hold on to that 1-1 draw. They were really going for it. It had a couple opportunities. I remember the one cannoned off the crossbar that Joel made a good save off the corner kick, and then just a whippage on the shot went right over him, and pretty fortunate to have that cannon back. But, you know, is that something that you tell your guys, like, hey, we're a man up, we should possess more and be smarter, but AB kind of had a fire under them in their own rights?
Well, that's always the way it is, and we actually did talk about that at halftime, that, you know, when you're down a man, you're probably going to outwork the team with 11 because you need to. The team with 11 thinks, okay, we got this in the bag because we're up a player. So it was a little bit of just kind of matching that momentum. I mean, they still came out, like you said, they were, you know, they're fairly direct, and they were trying to play in their long diagonals and getting guys in, and that's where they were dangerous when they got the ball out wide to the flanks and could serve balls into the box. But we also did a better job, I thought, of pressing them, not giving them time in the back to play. That created a handful of turnovers that, you know, led to our scoring opportunities. So we kind of made sure we didn't sit back and let the game come to us. We tried to take the game to them a little bit more, put them on the back foot, force some long turnovers. I thought that's kind of what we did. And, you know, the man advantage, you know, should help. So it was, you know, you got to find the extra player when you can always get a 2v1 somewhere on the field.
Absolutely, and a position where you kind of have a 2v1 in your own team is, you mentioned earlier about center back, and Andrew Vasquez has returned to the side. He returned last week against Concord, missed the first couple games of the season. He formed a pretty good partnership with Isaiah Dell there in that second half, and Isaiah had a really, really nice sliding tackle with about 8 or 9 minutes left to prevent an AB chance. But you also have Gage Adam, who also has played there. So are you kind of rotating those three and just trying to get a good partnership at certain times of the game? Or is it you feel confident in two guys and then you just have an extra for when you need him?
I think we got three guys that can play. I mean, actually, Gage and Dell played out the second half as the center backs, and Andrew wasn't in when we switched the midfield because maybe we had an extra player, so we wanted to get him more of a playmaker in there. But Andrew's still working himself back from the early season injury, so I don't think he's quite 100%, but he's working hard, and it's nice knowing I've got three guys that we can rotate, and some, you know, probably Gage is the guy we could move around the most because of what he did last year. But they, yeah, they all have different strengths and weaknesses, so sometimes it just depends. So we need ball winners, we need guys that are good on the ball, we need communicators, so we have the luxury of being able to kind of mix and match based on what the game presents.
And certainly something that I saw in Isaiah and Gage at the end is that both of them are pretty no-nonsense defenders, where if the ball needs to be cleared away, they're just going to clear it out and not risk another sloppy back pass like we saw in the first half. They're just going to kind of do what's asked of them and not take any risks there at the back.
Yeah, I mean, they're, you know, I think we kind of learned our lesson. We had the wind with us, so if we were in trouble, let's just get it long and lock them in down on their end of the field and make them make the bad play. And, you know, you don't like playing long all the time, but, you know, I'd rather make them go 70, 80 yards to try to score than turn it over, forcing out of the back, and then we have to go 20 yards to score. That's kind of the mentality to go with it at times. And it's not the prettiest, but sometimes, yeah, we got to get the ball down the field.
Absolutely. And so you get a nice little break here. You get about 2 weeks to rest up and try to get some of the guys healthy before you travel out to Notre Dame in South Euclid. So certainly a time where you guys can focus on training, getting things right, and also just getting people healthy. A nice break in the middle of the season at the start here for you guys.
Yeah, it's perfect timing. You know, basically midway point for us, four games, then a bye, and then got the last four games to finish up. So, yeah, the plan is to get healthy, just kind of start fine-tuning some things as we go into the last stretch here. But then hopefully we're ready to, you know, get a very good Notre Dame team that we couldn't get points from last year, but we, you know, can battle with them twice to one goal losses. But, yeah, we've got to be a little bit better against them to get the 3 points.
And certainly we wish you luck in that game, and we thank you for taking the time out of your afternoon here to come and talk to us on the Bobcast.
All right, thanks for having me.